Hi everyone, welcome to the next episode of Keeping It Real with Aarti and me. Our episode today is titled Rising Stronger. So when you heard the title, you all thought, Rising Stronger, right? She's going to be talking about success and all of that. No, we're going to be talking about failure. Because a lot of us forget how important failure is, and I think it really deserves the kind of attention that it, you know, because it gives us so much to learn from, it makes us stronger and wiser. And I want to talk about my earliest memory of failure, right? And the way failure was dealt with in my family. As a child, I remember, and I must have been about 5 or 6. Even at 5 or 6, I distinctly remember this incident. I was running and I tripped and I fell flat like that, okay? And the moment I fell and I looked up, both my mom and dad clapped hands. And they said, well done, get up. So I got up. No big wound, very good, you didn't get hurt, well done. And they clapped. So for me, it was like, oh, I fell down, I got up, oh, I have succeeded in something. And then I continued. There was no shame or anything associated with it. That is my earliest memory of failure. What is yours?
Mine actually wasn't so positive. So, you know, I have a twin and he was like the super smart kid. He started reading when he was 2.5 years and he could read words like the contractor and all that at 2 years. Mm. And I wasn't really the greatest, you know, reading, writing kind of person. And my handwriting was pretty hopeless back then. So I used to have in UKG around the same time, around the 5 years. In UKG, I remember the teacher in my classroom would always make the statement, God's children have good handwriting. Devil's children have bad handwriting.
So terrible.
And the thing is, at that point, I'm just learning to write. So I don't know how to perfect the process. But I was always made to feel less than my brother, who was the super smart kid in the same class. And I was also made to believe that I was somehow the devil's child. And it didn't feel very good. In your case, it was very supportive. In my case, it was very demeaning. It diminished me. And it also made me feel really, really bad. Because no matter how much I tried, it was never good for her. Though I'm laughing now, because I just find it so funny now. At that point, I wanted to be God's child, right? And it wasn't...
And you can be that only if you have good handwriting, isn't it?
Yes. And you now know my handwriting is very good.
It's fabulous.
Right?
Yeah, so,
yeah. Yeah, I have lovely handwriting. Fortunately, I don't think it was influenced by that. But the point I'm trying to make is, you so beautifully started about rising stronger and how failure is important. We will all fail. We will all fail at some point in our life and many times in our life. In your case, there was a supportive environment because of which you were able to rise stronger. In my case, I decided to rise stronger. And irrespective of the experience, the onus is on us to use failure as the space from where I can rise stronger.
And the thing is, when you look at failure and you look at all the examples that we are very familiar with when it comes to failure, you look at a student, right? A student, if he doesn't get certain grades, if he doesn't get entry into certain colleges, failure. And if you look at a businessman who doesn't have a huge bank balance is considered a failure, or powerful, considered a failure. And if you look at, even as an actor, look at me as an example, right? So as an actor, for me, it is doing meaningful roles. And I've always loved what Marlon Brando has said. There are no small roles, there are only small actors, he says. You know, and for me, when it's beautiful, right? And I really subscribe to that theory, because any role, if you can do it to the best of your ability and with conviction, it'll just stand out, right? And in order to be able to do that, you choose your roles wisely. But in the standard definition of a successful actor, you need to have blockbuster movies, you need to have huge awards, a list of awards, and huge popularity, right? So if you look at the standard definition of an actor, according to the public opinion, then I'm not what anyone would classify as a successful actor. But if you look at my definition, I am a successful actor, right? And there are other examples. Housewife. If you're a successful housewife, your house will be sparkling clean. You will be well-dressed. And the most frustrating thing is about this COVID. During COVID, if you are productive, you would have learned a new skill. Use the time and learnt a new skill. I think, boss, this is like time of tremendous stress. Don't come and tell me. But I think there must be a commonality in all of this, don't you think?
Yeah, and they come from the traditional definitions of success, which have three major components. The first component of success is where the product is always highlighted and never the process. And if you really look at real examples or real life, the process is as rich as the outcome. But we don't look at the process where failure could be a part, but we look at this product, like you said, the businessman having a bank balance or power, student having grades, a lady having a beautiful home, or you know, having certifications and things like that, awards and certifications. The second aspect is where as a world, or you know, an entire population, we took having more as being more important than being more. I'd rather be valued for what I have than who I am. Yeah? When I don't value who I am, then what's the point? Like, I may have lovely qualities of empathy, of compassion, of just being spontaneous and playful, but that's not as important as being articulate, powerful.
Or even wearing fancy clothes and having a fancy thing, coming in a fancy car. Right?
Yes. And you know, those tangibles, those having more means the tangibles are more important than the intangible, you know, and that's what it is. And the third aspect is these definitions of winners and losers. So if you really look at it, we always like to, you know, back the person who's winning. We'd rather be with the winning side than with the losing side. And if someone loses, we have to immediately shame them, and then we have to say they cheated.
Have you noticed that some people are so afraid of being seen, especially if they are not secure enough? The moment that person is perceived as a failure, they start distancing themselves almost as if that failure is contagious.
And it's not a gradual process like you showed. It's like a
sudden, no, it's like, but
you know, I won't. Yeah, exactly. You know, I've had that example. You know, I used to head a school. I was working for someone. I was heading a school. And at one point, you know, there was some small misunderstanding, and I stepped down. All these parents of the school who were till now my closest contacts on the phone, they just distanced themselves. You know, even if I would call, they wouldn't speak. And it was an instant overnight thing. And I just realized at that point, they didn't like me. They liked the power that I had. And that's also one of the reasons why failure becomes something that people want to hide, or, you know, shove under the carpet or run away from. And that's the thing that I think we need to start addressing, because unless we understand that these intangibles are as important as the tangibles of success, we will never be able to live a productive, beautiful life.
But then, no, Aarti, if you, what you say is so true, and I think it is so crucial that we understand that this fear of failure is actually indoctrination, right?
Yes, it is. Because failure actually won't do anything to you, Anu. Like, we've failed enough number of times. We can write 50 books on failure and we'll still be bestsellers, kind of thing. But failure doesn't do anything. In fact, it gives you the opportunity to improve, to grow, to be a better person. But fear of failure presents itself in so many ways that many people don't understand that what they're doing every day is actually avoiding failure. They think, you know, it's something else. And if I can give you some examples that will make it very, very interesting for people. The first way in which fear of failure manifests is jealousy and competition. You know, it's so deeply ingrained in our psyche that we should compete that we don't realize that fear of failure can also be this competition. I'll give you the classic example. So I started my career as a school counselor in a local school, which was very, very popular. And the primary section used to be in one side of the campus, and I would be looking at mothers coming to pick up the kids around 3:30 and all that. And the kids will come down as soon as the bell rings, and they'll come, chuck their bag, and they'll go off to the ground and play. This was about 20 years back. And then you'll see these mothers feverishly removing the test notebook from the bag. And then they'll be like comparing, how much did your daughter get? What has my daughter got? And the mother will say, tomorrow I'm going to go and gift the teacher a lipstick. that means my child will get better marks next time. And I used to be so shocked because I know my parents have never come to school to, you know, compare my marks.
Or bribe the teacher.
Bribe the teacher, definitely. You know, and the thing is, maximum they would say next time study better, or, you know, I'll take away these this special class that I have, or sports or something. But it was never at the level of sabotaging and manipulating somebody else that I needed to succeed. But for me, it was a paradigm shift. I mean, I went back to that school almost 10 years after I'd finished schooling. So when I'd seen how fear of failure was manifesting, it was such a scary thing. The mothers were jealous. The mothers were insecure. They were competing against each other. And the children couldn't care less. They were playing. But the way in which they were trying to avoid failure at any cost and cushion their children from failure was probably what was most scary for me, because they were also teaching the children there and that failure is wrong.
You are talking about so many years ago. Let me tell you about what is happening in reality shows. When kids come to perform in reality shows, and I've seen it, I'm not a big fan of that because I believe that we're teaching the children really wrong approach to life, but that's a different argument. But what I have seen happen is I've seen parents tell the child, see, the judges come back after a long break, tell the judge that you missed her. And then this kid will immediately start saying, ma'am, we missed you so much, ma'am. I said, that is an innocent child. What are you teaching him? You're teaching that child that you must suck up to a person who's a decision maker. Doesn't matter what your, you know, abilities are, but these are the things that will give you an edge.
And that is the second manifestation of this fear of failure, which is sabotaging outcomes and also backbiting. Because what will happen here, they're teaching them to suck up to one judge and also backbiting about another participant and so on. If you've actually seen some of these TRP games that people actually play, they'll be talking about somebody else, you were not fair, you were not this. And I would wonder, how can so much of meanness come out on one stage? So the third pattern is blaming, shaming, trolling and bullying. And I think you were probably the best person to speak about it, right? So that
when my page was a little quieter, there wasn't so much negativity. The moment it gained a bit of traction during this lockdown, the negativity just shot up. And I initially thought it was just, you know, par for course. And then I realized it's not that. It's just that people don't like it when someone says good things about someone else and they're jealous. So because they're jealous and insecure, they want to somehow bring that person down. And how do they bring that person down? By trolling and bullying them. Right? And I've seen earlier it used to affect me, and then I realized it's not about me, it's about them. So that helped me deal with it. But this is obviously, they don't feel successful enough. They are afraid that they are failures, and they are, you know, kind of taking it out on someone else.
And intruding so much space. It's not their wall, it's somebody else's wall. And I feel I can, you know, override all your boundaries and shame you because I'm not feeling successful enough. And that's a very typical fear of failure pattern. And the next pattern is anxiety and fear of failure. And the classic example is of the student who doesn't want to write the exam, develops the writer's cramp, develops anxiety related issues which are preventing them from writing the exams. I knew the answer, ma'am, but I couldn't write.
I get fever before the exam.
Fever before the exam, all those somatization, as we call it, you know, those secondary characteristics that happen. So all of this leads to the fear of failure. So I don't want to fail, so I develop something that prevents me from performing. And I can always say, you know, it was because of that fever that I couldn't, or I was not able to sleep, so I couldn't study,
yeah,
and so on.
Yeah, yeah.
The next pattern is our pattern, workaholism and burnout. Okay, and I think we can write some more books about it. We have enough to write about.
Yeah.
So as you know, both of us work so much, and if we're not working, we're not productive.
Yeah.
And that's from fear of failure. And it's a very deeply indoctrined pattern as well.
No, what about this episode? This episode that we planned. So, okay, let me tell you the story about this episode, okay? So now you understand Aarti does a lot of things other than just this. And I do a lot of things other than just keeping it real, right? So we both do quite a lot of other different things. And we are both working at a really hectic pace. the first 3 weeks, every week we will, film it. And then I will sit and edit the whole thing. And then we'll share it with each other. And then, the whole thing, creating the poster, everything. So we're working at this
also,
pace.
Also, not just recording and editing, our discussion meetings for content will go on for hours and hours.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there was just endless preparation that would go in because it had to be so spontaneous.
Right? Yeah, yeah. So we were doing that. And then what happened? 3 weeks we did this. And then comes the fourth week. And both of us have a huge number of things on our plate. Now, neither wants to say that we are overwhelmed. Okay? Because saying we are overwhelmed means then, we are letting ourselves down and we are just being lazy, we are not being productive and all of that. And then I asked Aarti, so this week, you want to do it this week? And she said, yeah, okay. And then
I'm sending after one content now.
Content. Then one day later, Aarti will say, I'm working on the content. So this week, are you sure you want to do it this week? She'll ask me. And then I'll say, yeah,
are you
yeah.
okay?
This back and forth went for quite some time until I think it was only Aarti who finally said, you know what? What do you think we take a break and then, prepare properly and then come back 1 week later? And you should have seen my immediate message to her was, I am so relieved. Yeah, because I was so pressurized. There was too much work. And then she's saying, yeah, even I'm feeling relieved. And what the point I want to make is, see, we are such good friends. We are so comfortable with each other. There is no ego. There's nothing. It's just this deeply ingrained belief as to why we should work so hard and why we must continue to be productive, right? And I think that is that old fear of failure that stops us from being practical.
Very much, very much. And in fact, when so many of them messaged us separately saying we missed your episode, is it coming out this week? Then one small guilt time also came. Oh my God, so many people are waiting.
That also.
And of course, I'm so glad we can share it openly with the group because, I'm sure many of them can resonate with this as well. And the next pattern is perfection and control.
Perfection and control I've seen with quite a few people. Because they're afraid of failing, they make a plan. Okay? Then the plan has a backup. And the backup has every backup has an alternative. This is how they approach everything. To be fair, I approach most things in life like that. If this goes wrong, I will do that. If that goes wrong, I will do that. Yeah? But some people take it to a completely different level. When it comes to something as simple as, let's say, so you have this hairbrush, okay? This hairbrush has to be repaired. Now, the hairbrush has to be repaired. It's on this table. So, this person I know will go and tell the first person saying that, hey, listen, that hairbrush is there. It has to be repaired. Then, we'll go and tell another person also saying that hairbrush is there on the table. It has to be repaired. And call up that man Murthy or whatever his name is and tell him, okay. The same thing will be told to three different people. Now, all these three people, because they're all like, oh, you told me do it, we'll do it. All three of us will call up this poor gentleman, Mr. Murthy, and tell him, hello, this hairbrush has to be repaired. And he's getting frustrated. Hello, what three of you call up one simple hairbrush? Why three of you are calling? So this is like excessive obsessing about control over the process because they don't want to lose and they don't want to fail at something even as simple as repairing this hair.
Exactly. And so can you imagine how frustrating it will be to live with somebody like that? If for a hairbrush, they can remind three people, it must be so scary. But that also comes from fear of failure. So I'd rather have perfection.
Yeah. And can you imagine the stress that person is under? Because if everything has to be so perfect, it has to be so aligned, work like clockwork, and that is your expectation of life, which inherently is imperfect, then it's such a stressful life that you're setting yourself up for.
Exactly. And my next pattern is what I call the peacock syndrome. The peacock is very beautiful as a bird, national bird and all that. And I'm using it as a metaphor because the peacock also has a very ugly voice.
If you heard
a peacock, it has an ugly voice. So the moment somebody challenges the bird about its voice, what will it do? I'll put my feathers out and say, listen, you can't talk about my voice because I have these beautiful feathers. And the classic example I can tell you of this lady who basically had a marriage that was failing. It wasn't one of those very intimate marriages, like no matter how much work she was putting into it, it wasn't really panning out the way she wanted. And so what she would do, go out of her way to entertain people at home and make these parties of hers the talk of the town. Mm. And you know what she was doing? She was trying to say, see, something in my life is not okay, but let me show you how great my life is. And so what was happening, she was never dealing with the really difficult part of her life, which needed work, but she was working on the other part. And that's typically from fear of failure, because I don't want to be called a failure in my marriage. So tomorrow, if something were to happen, people would say, oh, everything was okay, this suddenly something happened. It's not because of her.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That is the typical peacock syndrome. And I'm sure many people can relate to similar examples. This is quite...
It's quite saddening.
Yes, it is. Yeah. It is. Because, you know, if you just understand that sometimes relationships are not in your control, and, you know, you've done your best, but it may not work out, it may give you a lot more peace to, you know, work on yourself and see what you can do, than try to keep always putting out this front. And it's so dangerous, you know, because it'll burn you out in the process. Coming to the next pattern, lack of playfulness and spontaneity. And that is like one of those typical patterns, because, you know, the moment you start losing spontaneity, you lose everything in life. And, you know, there is this jewelry designer I used to know, and she was like a very, you know, one of those quirky designers. Like, I used to love her because, you know, you'll just wonder, how did you even see that connection? What we call the synthetic creativity was so brilliant in her. She'll just make the most amazing designs, and out of just nothing, you know, she was that good. And so then what happened, she got like somebody to invest in her idea as a great startup. And then what happened was, because she scaled up her business, her creative time became less, and she was doing things like administration, working with a team and all that, which were not really her forte. And after a point, you know, that spontaneity in her, that joy in her, that you know, that drive to live would started diminishing. She lost control over her team, the team that was always playful, meeting over dinner, you know, things like that. And at one point, I think, you know, what she did was she just sold the company. And she said, no, this is not how I want to live. I want to be able to be playful and creative again. And then when she did that, and she retained, or she returned to her playfulness and spontaneity, it made such a big difference to her. But many times, because we are scared to fail, we give up on being playful, we give up on being spontaneous, which makes us real. And that is one dangerous fear of failure.
A lot of people, because they want to succeed, they think that I can succeed only if I do it like this.
If
right?
I'm serious and I'm focused and I'm all of these things, right? And focus can come in play. Children, when you see children playing, they're so focused. It's not because they want to win. They focus because they love what they're doing. You can be focused and spontaneous and playful, but you don't need to be focused, serious and constipated in that sense, if I would put the obsessed with it, right? And the last pattern, I don't even think we need to give an example. Everybody knows it. The fear of failure manifests as procrastination. I want to delay it as much as I can, because if I don't start, I won't fail. And these are the ways in which fear of failure manifests. So I think we've sort of given a complete picture of it, and it should be something that we can all identify in our life.
And it'll also help us when we look at certain behavior patterns, then we can stop and say, where is it coming from? Is it coming from my fear of failure? And then we can go back. Because the other thing I think, Aarti, we need to look at is what failure does to us. You know, the impact that failure has on...
See, because the first thing that it does, it makes us feel very low. Self-worth is hit. Because, you know, almost always people tend to associate what they're doing and how much they're achieving to what they're worth personally, right? That's the first. And associated with that, the moment my worth goes down as a person internally, I feel excluded by everyone. And as human beings, we are relational beings, we like to be included. None of us likes to be excluded or rejected from a group. So let's assume that, you know, I had like this huge business empire, I had all of this, and I was included in this really hi-fi group, and suddenly now I can no longer belong there. I can no longer even fit in there. Belonging is secondary. I can't even fit in there because I don't check all the boxes. And that is the first impact of it.
We are able to talk about failure once we have seen some kind of a success, right? When I talk about my failure in, you know, my personal life or my failure financially, all of that comes from the confidence I've gotten because I've subsequently managed to succeed in it. And I think what we also need to understand is, yeah, we learned from those failures and we succeeded, maybe. But the confidence comes only afterwards. During that time, I don't feel worthy enough or confident enough to talk. You know, like at 35, you knew me when I was 35. Did you know I was broke? No.
Yeah, I didn't.
I never told you, right? Because it was a matter of shame for me. So I didn't tell anyone that I was broke. And I think it kind of carries on throughout, you know, it also kinds of gives you this little bit of a fear.
And that's the second impact.
Yeah, because I think the same break, being broke, actually what happened was I became extremely conservative in the way I spent money.
Right, because you start, you know, shrinking in a sense. But, you know, living in fear is also manifested differently because some people cover up that fear. At least you're telling me I became conservative. But I know of a family that has lost a lot of money. Mm-hmm. In fact, they've overborrowed and everything. But still, just out of fear of, you know, being called failures, they're continuing to maintain that
lifestyle,
fancy life that they have, that lifestyle, so that people don't think anything of them. And you know, it increases that fear because every month they're borrowing X amount of money from different people and they're continuing to actually bury themselves deeper into this nonsense called failure, as opposed to just coming out and saying, listen, I think we've made mistakes, I think this has happened, and I think we need to look for real solutions here. And that's not happening. And the third and the more dangerous thing is shrinking and refusing to look for options. You know, I start shrinking so much because of my failure. Because, you know, you have seen me as a failure now. I'm going to just, you know, avoid all of you.
Yeah.
I'm going to isolate myself. I'm going to disappear from the face of the earth. Oh, maybe you should share.
No, because this has happened with someone whom I was incredibly close, right? Incredibly close with her. And then something happened, which was a very big failure in her life. And I was there at that time. After that, she just cut me out from her life because I was representative of her failure. She didn't want me to remind her of that failure. So despite the love, despite the affection and everything, she wanted to have nothing to do with me. And that's it. I have had no contact for the past several years.
That's scary, isn't it? Because, you know, you won't even be responsible for it, but you'll be, you know, somewhere that reminder for them, and it's very scary. And you know where shrinking also becomes dangerous, because if I do have any chance at succeeding, it should be only when I try again. You know, you had that beautiful quote about
my favorite failure, quote, right? That is my favorite quote. I always say, there were two things that I always say about it: you either win or you learn. That's what I say. But my favorite, all-time favorite, is life is like boxing. You don't lose when you fall down, you lose when you fail to get up.
So again, like I said, the devil's handwriting that I had has become such a beautiful handwriting now, because you know, at some point I chose to make a difference. I chose to have this handwriting that could work for me. And so we'll move on to the next aspect of the reasons why people fail again and again. And if you see, some people tend to make the same kind of mistakes or the same kind of patterns persist. So if we were to look at reasons why people repeatedly fail, I've put them, so 9 patterns sort of emerged, and I've put them under 3 heads, so we sort of get an idea. And if you've been someone who's been failing repeatedly, it would be good for you to look at this. The first aspect, of course, is always in the attitude. How do I start internally? How do I look at my life? How do I look at things? So when I believe that I don't deserve success, or I don't deserve something good in my life, that directly sabotages any chance I have of succeeding. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to do half-hearted things. I'm going to do things constantly driven by the self-doubt that I won't be able to achieve. That's the first. The second is when I don't think it's possible. I come up with a great strategy, great idea, all of that, but somewhere at the back of my mind, I'm like, I don't think this is going to work. இது எல்லாம் பாசிபிள் இல்லை யூனோ தட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் திங் ஸோ யூனோ தட்ஸ் தட் மைண்ட் வாய்ஸ் அஸ் சம் ஆஃப் ஆர் யங்கர் ஜென்ரேஷன்ஸ் டாக் அபவுட் மைண்ட் வாய்ஸ் செட் இட்ஸ் நாட் பாசிபிள் ஸோ இட்ஸ் ரியலி யூனோ ஐ எம் டூயிங் சம்திங் பட் இட் தம் பேக் ஆஃப் மை மைண்ட்
த கன்விக்ஷன் இஸ் நாட் தேர்
இட்ஸ் டெஃபினெட்லி நாட் தேர் ஐ எம் நாட் ஆல் இன் ஐ எம் நாட் கம்ப்ளீட்லி தேர் பட் த தேர்ட் அண்ட் ஐ ஃபீல் வாட் இஸ் மோர் டேஞ்சரஸ் ஆட்டிடியூட்னலி இஸ் த லேக் ஆஃப் ஹியூமிலிட்டி And failure, paradoxically, failure teaches us humility. But when I do not have the humility enough to believe that I may not know everything, that I do not have everything, and I need to gently keep teaching myself these things, I can't achieve as an object of will. Just by willpower, I'll become powerful. No, I become powerful when I'm humble. And I have a beautiful story, Anu. So there is this, it's about the Grand Canyon, if you've seen the Grand Canyon. Mm-hmm. Story was so beautiful that I had to share it. So there is this girl who is very, very upset that, you know, she's crippled, like she's in an accident and she's lost sensation on her feet. And so she's on a wheelchair and somebody comes and tells her, let me tell you the story of the Grand Canyon. So she's very angry and upset and all of that. And then she says, apparently, and this story is about, you know, God, the creator, walking on a plane, and he sees that his favorite flowers are not in this particular garden. He asks the birds of the sky to bring the seeds and sow them there so that his favorite flowers could bloom. They bring the seeds, but it doesn't sprout. That's because it's too windy. So then, you know, the birds say this is the problem. So he says, okay, let me send the lightning down. The lightning comes and it, you know, splits the earth. And the canyon is formed. The moment the canyon is formed, the wind goes there. And so the beautiful flowers are able to blossom on the other side. And you know, failure is sort of like that. When we're broken so much, it takes away some of those things that actually limit us from growing. And then those beautiful flowers like humility, of believing in ourselves, of trusting that better things can happen, grow only in that ground. And I think if we can understand that failure is the only thing that sometimes gives us that growth, we probably have a better chance at living a good life.
But from a personal front also, if you look at it as if you're constantly looking at, I want to improve, I want to be the best version of myself. And I think failure teaches you that. How you can progressively move towards the best version of yourself.
Much. And I think that's what drives both of us, right? I mean, we are crazy like that, like always. When we are generating content, we're like, how can we make this better? How can we make this better? And that's how we work with ourselves as well. And I think that's also why people resonate with it at a totally different level. And the second set of reasons why people don't succeed as much is the action level. So that is when I'm not persistent enough. So I decide, I'm very excited with the idea and all that, I have a great strategy, but I'm not persistent. I do it once and then I don't have the discipline that's required, or I do it several times and it doesn't work out and things like that. That's the next. The second is where I'm too distracted. I've already taken too many things onto my plate and I'm not able to do this. And this is a very dangerous pattern as well, because when I'm so distracted, I'm not going to be able to do anything productive. I'm doing a little of this, little bit of this, little bit of this, and I'm not able to succeed. And that is a very dangerous pattern as well. And the third one, more important, I don't take responsibility for my actions. So something happens, I actually mess up something, I don't want to take responsibility, I blame someone else, I blame the time, I blame the direction, I blame the charts, I blame everything else, but I don't want to take responsibility. Blaming is external, responsibility is internal.
Yeah.
And that becomes the next problem.
I think we need to add one more here, which is this inability to prioritize when you are doing
something.
You know, that inability to prioritize is, again, and at an action level, I think people make this mistake over and over again.
It's a problem, and that's the reason they are distracted, you know, because if I don't prioritize, I tend to, you know, look at this, look at that, and I'm, you know, I think I'm being productive, but I'm actually just, you know, wasting or whiling away time. And the third area why we repeatedly fail, one is because subconsciously I'm scared to stand out in a crowd. And you know, these statements like
it's lonely at the top,
those kind of things and all, you know? So somewhere I'm such a relational being, I don't want to be lonely on top. So in fact, if you see, sometimes some of those popular successful people are always shown they're shown as very miserable people. So if you look at it, like, you know, some really fancy things, they don't have great relationships or something like that. It's very dangerous as a model, because, you know, you can balance all of this and still live a great life, but the typical role models are shown in a negative sense. The second is not having sufficient networks or connections, because when you need to make it in life, the people you surround yourselves with are very important. And, you know, having only yes men is also dangerous. Having too many critical people is also dangerous. Having people who pull you down, who don't trust in you, are also dangerous. And not having the right networks, like to push some ideas through, I may need certain specific networks and I may not have that. That could be a problem.
I have seen that how a person's personal development got so stunted because they were surrounded only by yes men. You know, I have seen it happen, because the potential is tremendous, but there isn't anyone who's there to keep them grounded, keep them, you know, understand the reality. But they keep saying that, oh, whatever you say is correct. Oh, that was a genius idea. You know, the moment, and they're giving them a false sense of, you know, what is the way of the world, right?
Honestly, that's what's happened in the world of politics. You know, if you really take politics, a lot of yes men around some of the greatest leaders have made even the greatest statesmen fall, you know, and that's very dangerous. We need to look at history and, you know, analyze this very safely. And the last aspect of the relationships is where I get healthy advice from somebody, but I argue against it because I feel I know better.
Of course. Of course,
and
I know
that's
better.
Dangerous. Of course, I know better. So arguing it, and I have like a classical example which I'll share a little later, because, you know, it sort of fits into that. Because somewhere I feel you are telling me not to do this because you don't want me to succeed, right? And that is where I argue against even your well-intentioned advice. So somebody has good intentions for you, tells you, you know, maybe this won't work out. But I come from a space saying, who are you to tell me? You know, do you know better than me? I know better than you.
And I suspect your motive also.
Exactly. And this arguing against advice is something very, very dangerous, because the younger the person, the arguments are stronger. Because, you know, with age, you know, you sort of realize this person has good intentions, this one doesn't. But when the person is younger, they feel their parents are just trying to, you know, sabotage their growth or something like that. And arguing against advice that is well-intentioned becomes a very big problem. So these would be typically the three categories within which there are reasons why we repeatedly fail.
I think we do need to recap so that people can get an idea as to how they can kind of improve on this. One is, it's the way you approach, which is to do with just yourself. The other is your actions. And the third is your relationships.
Yes. And so if we can look at it that way, it's easier for us to move forward in terms of making a correctional set of steps or something like that, or looking at what we can learn. And that's where I think we need to understand what failure really teaches us. Because if we do not acknowledge what failure can teach us, apart from individual lessons, we need to acknowledge that failure gives us a lot of experience that cannot be brought in by any amount of success. And so that's where I said I'll speak later about this, because it's a classic example, you know. So I argued against advice. I did everything possibly there. So, you know, I'm like this person who wanted to set up a model school and all those things, and I never had the financial backing for it. And because nobody is an educationist in my family, I didn't have any support for it. So when somebody approached me to set up a school, everyone else who had good intentions for me said, how can you partner with those people? Your values are different. You are somebody who believes in service and quality and all that, and they are money lenders who will look for, you know, how to cut corners, all those things. And I kept saying, no, even if our values are different, I think we can learn from each other, because I thought they're going to learn from me how to serve and I'm going to learn from them how to probably, you know, balance out investment and all. I was sadly mistaken, and everybody, including my dad, who's never interfered in my work, said, you know, the first meeting we had, these people started the meeting 1.5 hours late, and you know how I am with punctuality, like 1 minute means 1 minute. And I remember my dad was in the audience and he said, are you sure you want to work with these people? And I was like, Daddy, don't be negative. you know, I'm going to make it in life and all that. And you know, all of you are just jealous that I'm growing and all that. After 1 year, I fell flat on my face. I couldn't work with them. They just could not cooperate with me. Every day I would wake up crying and I would just feel miserable about it. I failed awfully. But what I learned, the experience that I got from that and the knowledge that I got, you can never partner with people who have different values. You may have different skills in partner because you will complement each other. You may have diversity in many other things and you can partner together. But when your values are different, you can never partner together. And that was one of the most brilliant experiences and pieces of knowledge that I got. So subsequently, wherever I worked, I ensured that people I worked with had values that were similar to me. And it was probably only failure at that magnitude that could help me. Of course, it crumbled. My world crumbled. For 4 years, I had no growth, but it was worth it. Well worth it.
Yeah. What you learned in a professional arena, I learned in a personal arena. I learned that you cannot have a relationship when the values are so different. And I tried whatever I could to make it work. You know, and I had made huge decisions. I had made huge changes in my life because I believed I would make it work. And then I realized that at the very basic level, at the ground, what is the most essential of values, we were different.
Right. And the third thing that failure teaches us is resilience. And I think you have an example to share with us on that.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. No, the thing is, I think being broke actually was a lesson in resilience for me, because I was broke, but I was not broken. You know, I just said, this is not what I want. I don't like it. It's shameful that I'm broke at 35, that I'm borrowing money from my father, but I will set it right. You know, so I kind of worked. I really worked very hard. Okay, I probably went on the other extreme, but still I worked very hard and I bounced back. I mean, I could have, you know, my life was in shambles. My personal life was in shambles. I had no money. I had nowhere to go. I had no career. So I could have just kind of crumbled, but I continued. And because I continued like that, once you see one failure and you get through one failure, it gives you the resilience and strength to get through others. You know, I think it's like just keeps on shoring your strength. And I feel that's what happened to me. So now, even though now I'm financially very secure and I'm very comfortable with the place where I am with in terms of finances, I know if tomorrow, because of the COVID situation, if I'm again going to have to start from scratch, so be it. We will all do it. We will get there, you know. So that's the belief I have. And I think I get that if I had never seen that failure, if I'd never been broke before, I'd have been terribly scared. But I've been broke before. I'm not scared.
Wow. And that's such a beautiful sharing too, because you know, the COVID situation has shaken so many people.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
In a day, I received at least 500 messages in different forms and on different platforms from people really scared about the future. And if we can just take one moment at a time, that gives us the courage to be resilient. And the next aspect of failure that failure teaches us is growth. And
yes,
you had that beautiful example about auditions. I think you should tell people, because, you know, I learned so much from that too.
So the thing is, we're all conditioned, right, with the way people treat us. And in India, having worked in the film and television industry for 25 years, I was an established person and I had a certain standing in this industry, and people treated me a particular way, right? But when I went to the UK, nobody cares whether you have 25 years of experience before. More importantly, nobody cares whether you're a Hassan. No one cares about your surname, okay? You have to go for the audition. And the first time I went for that audition, I was a bit taken aback. And I've shared this before in many interviews as well, but it's a wonderful learning. So I'm happy to share it again. So I go to the audition and I see people who have never been before the camera, who've never ever acted in their life, who are very clearly no idea as to how to perform. They are there. And I'm on the same platform, or I'm seen as on the same level as them, right? And then you have to audition. And you have to audition. Believe me, these auditions, I will go for 10 auditions, I will get through one. 9 auditions, I'll fail. Okay? And then maybe once I got through 2 or 3 auditions, right? And then they won't, and you're like, you're having to face the fact that you didn't get it. And you know that you're good, but you didn't get it, you know? So all of this, it taught me, I kept going in for auditions. I didn't give up. I kept going in for auditions. And if I am now someone with an experience of having worked in BBC, if I worked in with very big directors, very big filmmakers like Russell T. Davies, who's responsible for Doctor Who's, resurrection. So big, huge guys like that, then it's only because I continue to keep, you know, going for the auditions despite the failures, and it kind of helped me grow in a direction I never anticipated.
Wow. And the last lesson from failure is that it increases your value, because you are much richer in terms of experience, in terms of knowledge, in terms of resilience, and in terms of growth, that it increases your value. So when I closed down my school, which was essentially a very big failure, after 14 years of running something, you close it down. Now I'm called to support schools because I have the kind of lessons that they don't have anymore. Startups love me because I've failed and now I can support them to grow. And, you know, it's increased my value as a person, as a consultant, as an educationist, as a psychologist, because all of those failures put together have such a rich blend of experiences and learning that I can now give value to someone else. And I think these are very rich experiences, and I'm sure failure can teach so many of us so many great lessons. So I think we should sum up with sort of like the prescriptive part.
Yes.
Meaning, you know, I think people love when they can do something about it.
Of course.
We all know this. And, you know, like Galileo says, you can never teach anyone something new. You can just take their awareness to what they already know. So we'll take them there. So there are 3 levels at which we can look at how we can set right things. The first is the how mistakes. So basically, when you fail, you do make some mistakes and all that. So the how mistakes are almost always your personal decisions.
Yeah.
So for example, my self-discipline. Am I disciplined enough? So when you mentioned I'm not prioritizing, that's a how mistake. Why am I not prioritizing? Then the next one, I'm not calculating the situation well. I'm not measuring well enough to know what needs to be done. Because unless I measure the situation, I won't know what to do. There. I can't just go there and spontaneously take off. You know, some things require measurement. And then another way in which we mess up this is I'm lazy to the details. Sometimes to be successful at some things, details is very important. And when I'm lazy to the details, then it becomes a problem. Right? The second set of mistakes are the what mistakes. And the what mistakes are when I have a strategy, a couple of strategies, but I don't know what strategy to use. And I think, hey, you have an example, right? I think you should share that.
Oh, the squash.
That's like the classic one. You should probably tell them that.
Yeah, yeah. So at around the time when Aarti and I met, I was also doing Coffee with Anu, but I was also running a chain of fruit juice and smoothie stores, which was started off as a business which would provide employment for women in a lower socioeconomic strata. So it was a great idea. I still think it was a great idea. And it was modeled along the Boost bars in Australia. So it was an open floor plan and all of that. But the thing is, while the idea was great, we weren't very clear about the strategy. You know, how were we going to grow? I knew that I wanted to have 20 stores and that I wanted to give employment for 300 girls. But how was I going to do it? So then we said, okay, there are 4 models that we've got. One is a standalone store model. The other is a standalone store model plus training center. The third is something which is inside an IT company. And the fourth is something that is in a mall, a cinema complex, where footfalls are already there. And you have, Aarti, come to the one in Egmore, which was a standalone store. We even have a picture that we can share.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
So that's the picture.
In fact, I was so excited about Anu's ideas. Anybody and everybody I would take to Anu's store.
Yeah.
Take her to Mayajal, go there to the training center. That was the training center as well. And get all excited. I'll get all my friends to see they're all women here and everything.
Yeah.
And I think like madness, I would bring people to the store.
No, and the thing is, no, sir, I had all friends supporting me. But if you look at the strategy, it wasn't working. You know why? Because we should have stuck to the one in Mayajal. We should have stuck to the one in the IT company. And we should have abandoned the standalone store, because the overheads that we were incurring as part of the standalone store and the training center was eating away into any profit that we were making from the other two models. And we weren't able to pivot fast enough and say, hey, this model isn't working, let's do this. Because we had reached a stage where I'm a phase A person, because I'm the one who puts a blueprint. And my phase B person has to grow and make it bigger. And then we realized that I don't have the bandwidth to kind of redraw the blueprint, and my phase B person didn't have the energy to expand. And ultimately what we did was we just had to sell that business. And we sold it to someone who ran it only for about maybe a year or so. So regardless of how many friends are willing to support you, how hardworking you are, because I used to work really mad, you know, I used to drive from one corner of Madras to the other. Regardless of all that, if your strategy is wrong, nothing is going to work.
And that is the typical what mistake. You may have the greatest idea, your heart in the right place, but if you don't know what strategy to use, you will fail. And the third, which is the why mistake. And this is something that all of us need to sort of examine. Do I have a vision? Do I have purpose? What is the meaning of this? Many times people get into this because of voices that our childhood voices. I have to be this way, I have to do this, I have to make it in life, but they're not my vision statements, they're not my voices. And I can give you the best example. When the school started in Salem, it was not my vision, it was my business partner's vision to start a school. Always, I was the one who was good with children and I was a good therapist. But I loved also, you know, working with children in a school setting. So I had a shared vision along with somebody else, but it was never my vision. So there was no way I could have made it succeed, because I never believed I deserved it. I never believed that it would work. And my vision for my life was very different from what this was. It was, my vision for my life did not have an income generation plan. My vision for my life was to leave it more meaningful. And you know, there was a huge conflict. And since the vision wasn't clear, it was very diffuse. It couldn't make it. So even after 14 years of doing a great job, it could not be sustained on its own. And that is typically the three levels. So what we need to do is to look at, is this a how mistake? Is it something I can change in my own habits, in my own self-discipline patterns? Second, is it something that I need to define and pick up the right strategy for? If something's not working, what next? And the third, if vision is not okay, sit down, get in touch with yourself, get yourself aligned to what you really want to do. And then failure is something that can be part of the process, but it'll never pull you down. It'll be something that'll teach you gently, like a teacher saying, you know, I think maybe you can do this, maybe you can do this, maybe you do this. It'll never pull you down to the point that you can't rise again. So I have like a beautiful story, if we can say that, to sort of give closure to the whole thing, you know. So my nephew is like somebody that I love very deeply. He's 17. And when he was 4, he used to be here with my dad, mom and all that. And he was in LKG and he was sent a questionnaire from school. And you know, he had a lot of questions in English, and he was doing his homework, and he's like, what is your name? Who's your favorite tennis player, etc., etc. One of the questions was, who's your role model? Now, of course, you shouldn't ask a four-year-old who's your role model, because role model is something people understand much later. So he asked me, what is role model? So then in the best possible way, in Tamil, I explained to him, they want to know, who do you want to be like when you grow up? So then he looked at me so puzzled and he said, I want to be like me. Why will I want to be like anybody else? At 4 years, the child knew.
Yeah.
That you don't need to be like anyone else. You just need to be who you are. And if we can understand that and retain that innocence all our life, success and failure become just part of the journey. You know, and the wisdom that the child brought into my life that day stays on. Because that was the time I decided that I have to live my vision, that I need to overcome any failure by being true to myself.
When you are saying that the vision that a child gave you, gave you a focus as to where you want to go and what you want to do. For me, my own vision, I lost it in between and then I got it back again, which was, I remember I was telling you, as a child, when they asked me, what is your ambition in life? So I remember distinctly saying, be happy. That's my ambition in life, you know. And you were saying, when I mentioned that, oh, John Lennon also said the same thing. At that time, I didn't know John Lennon. I just knew that the most important thing is to be happy. But somewhere along the line, we all redefined success as something else, and we started chasing after many other things, and we lost that. So I think when we can look inward, and especially that third point, which is this your voice? That is very, very crucial, because once you know whether this is your voice or is it something that has been conditioned, then everything else falls into place and you'll find your way. Well, so that was what we wanted to share with you on this episode. This is the episode which we titled Rise Stronger. And we hope that with whatever we've shared, it has given you the opportunity to look inwards, look in the past and understand what has happened. And you can see that there is great hope in the future, regardless of what the future holds. Whether there is a lot of success, more failures, great. That means more lessons. We hope that you found this session useful. So now, Aarti, is it time for you to say bye? So she's getting ready.
I'm holding up the hand. I'm holding up the hand now.
She's saying, talk to the hand.
Hand. Oh, God.
Okay. Right then. Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Enjoyed the session. Bye. Bye.